two IPOs which are going to hit the market back to back starting 21st of September. Out of these two, we are going to cover this IPO today. Hi guys, Sia Rachana Ranade here, and I welcome you all to one more IPO review. My God, this is the first time that I'm doing a third IPO review in single month. But yes, IPOs are flooding the market, and it's my responsibility to make an attempt to explain all the concepts which are there in the IPO detailed as much as possible. So let's start with the CAMS IPO business review first. Business review is basically we need to understand what does it do. Okay. Number one, let me first tell you which are the basic business segments. So here you can see this is an entire array of services that CAMS provides. Let's understand one by one, what do they give? Number one, they're into electronic payment collection services business. Now, what does this mean? So whenever you give standing instructions, okay, let's say you're going to do a SIP in some mutual fund, then your bank account is debited and from that money, some units of mutual fund will be purchased. Okay. So this is the intermediary CAMS, which is going to debit your account and is going to purchase mutual fund units for you. So basically the platform will be different, but CAMS is acting as an intermediary. Okay. So it's more about electronic payment collection activity is being done by CAMS. Second one here you can see is insurance repository service. Now, what does this mean? Many of you might not be knowing that, these days now, you can also convert your physical insurance policies into a dematerialized form. Okay, so like you have shares in a DMAT account, you can also have your insurance policies in a dematerialized account. Okay, who provides this service? This same company, CAMS, provides you the service of converting your physical insurance policies into a DMAT policy, as well as storing these policies in the DMAT format. Okay. Third one is AIF business services. Okay, AIF services business. Now, what is AIF services business? In simple words, it's more of accounting and reporting service. Now, what does this mean? You can imagine that, as an example, SBI Mutual Fund, it's one of the biggest fund houses, mutual fund houses. It will have so many customers with them. Okay, now, which customer purchased how many units, at what price, whether any dividend was payable out of that amount or not, who is going to keep a record of all these transactions? It's going to be CAMS who is going to maintain the records of this. Okay, so CAMS is going to be acting like an entity who is going to do the accounting of all these transactions which are happening with the mutual fund, and they are also going to help in the reporting process, right? What is the next one? Next one is banking and non-banking financial services. It could be something like a facilitation of loan processing. So just as an example, I go to the bank, I tell them that I need a loan. Bank will give me a list of documents which are required for the loan. Then CAMS will come into picture and they will be verifying all these documents on behalf of the bank. Okay, they'll check the authenticity of these documents for the bank. And obviously, they're going to charge a fee to whom? Not to me, obviously. They're going to charge a fee to the bank. And bank will recover it from me as a loan processing fee or something like that. Okay, but that is meant by banking and non-banking. Okay, next one, you can also understand that next service that they provide is KYC registration agency services business. So everyone knows what is KYC. Know your customer, know your client. So they also provide these services to various financial institutions. And the last one is software solution business. This is also one of the most important services that they are providing to various mutual funds. Because you can imagine mutual funds require such advanced softwares. And these softwares are actually, CAMS helps them developing and maintaining these softwares. So these are all the services which are provided by CAMS. So this was just a brief introduction for you about the business model of CAMS. To apply for an IPO, you need a DMAT account. And if you want to open a DMAT account with one of the best discount brokers in India, I have put the link in the description box. So open an account with Zerodha and avail all the special benefits regarding my courses. Now that we have understood the business model, let's understand the revenue model of CAMS. Okay. In the previous section, I talked about accounting and reporting as one of the major services. So what does it do as a revenue model? These are the two major revenue models that the company has. Okay. Number one, if you check here, it is fees charged on AUM managed by the AMC for which MFRTA provides the service. Okay. I'm going to explain what it is. And second, it is for paper-based transactions. Now, what are these two? I'll quickly tell you. Wait. First, I talked about paper. Okay, second, I talked about was paper-based transaction. Means what? There's a lot of paperwork sometimes to be done. The name change, there's an address change, whatever. Whatever is the paper-based transactions, okay? For that, CAMS is going to charge some fee to the mutual fund houses, okay? But you only tell me, nowadays, everyone knows that somewhere the percentage of paperwork is going down. And as the percentage of digitization increases and paperwork goes down, this part of the revenue is going to decrease, okay? As on date, this revenue earned because of paper-based transaction is not even 20% of their total revenue. Then where does the major revenue come from? Major revenue, 80% of the revenue comes from the various services that they are providing to the mutual fund houses. In fact, you might be knowing this, that they serve a lot of big mutual fund houses and they are RTAs to many mutual fund houses. Now, what is RTA? RTA, Registrar and Transfer Agent. So what does a Registrar and Transfer Agent do? Just to simplify things, they'll do the accounting for whom they do the accounting, not only for the mutual fund houses, it is as good as each and every individual investor's record will also be maintained. Then if, let us say, any bonus units are to be issued to the investors, whether the bonus units are issued to them or not, properly credited to the person's account or not, everything is looked into by CAMS, who will be the RTA in this case. Okay, if you want to know more about RTAs and what all are the different parties in mutual funds, you can check out my course, which I have developed very recently, and very recently I came out with this course on mutual funds, right? Okay, coming back to the discussion. As I mentioned, they are giving services to mutual fund houses and 80% of the revenue comes from mutual fund houses. Okay, now let us understand one very important point here. How do they charge mutual fund houses? Based on what? They charge a percentage of the total AUMs of mutual fund houses. Okay, in simple words, let us say a mutual fund house has an AUM of 100 crore rupees. And let us say they are going to charge 1% of that as an example. Then how much will be CAMS revenue? CAMS revenue will be 1 crore rupees if the percentage charged is 1% of the total AUM. So you only tell me, higher the AUM, higher will be the revenue for CAMS. Okay, simple. Now you have to understand which all mutual fund houses are there. Top 10, let us consider only top 10. Top 10 mutual fund houses and how much is their AUM. So that's a list of top 10 AMCs for you. You can see here, SBI Mutual Fund, HDFC Mutual Fund, ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund, Aditya Birla Sun Life, Nippon, Kotak, Axis, UTI, IDFC and Franklin. These are the top 10 mutual fund houses. Okay. Now, if you check out the total assets under management, if you check out the total, directly total, it's 11,948 billion rupees. That's a huge total AUM. Okay, that's an average asset under management, by the way. If you check out the percentage wise, out of this total AUM of 11,948 billion rupees, SBI has a 14.7% share as on June 2020. HDFC has 14.4%. ICICI Prudential has 13.5%. Aditya Birla has 8.7%. And Nippon has 7.3% of market share. Now, you might be wondering that if I'm talking about the top 5 mutual fund houses, they themselves are having close to 51.3% of the total market share. Now, the best part to be understood here is that out of these top 5, 4 mutual funds are the clients of CAMS. Now, you can imagine, if this be so, what an amazing revenue can be generated for CAMS. And for that, you must also understand that out of the total market share of all the mutual fund houses, entire AUM, CAMS has an aggregate market share of 69.4%. So that's a huge market share that CAMS is having in the overall market. One more point to be understood here is that in the previous section, I gave you the example that CAMS generally charges a percentage of fees. Percentage of what? Percentage of AUM, correct? Just as an example, I said if AUM is 100 crore and let us say percentage of fee is 1%. That was just an example. But in reality, how much does CAMS charge? For that, you can check out this table. For equity funds, CAMS charges only 0.059%. Okay? Then for hybrid, it's 0.060%. For debt, 0.022. For liquid, 0.020. And for others, it's 0.015%. Now, the thing is that if you're talking about equity and hybrid, you can check out very easily top 2. It's the highest fees that CAMS charges, correct? One more point to be understood here is that if the AUM goes on increasing, okay, if AUM goes on increasing, this percentage comes down. Okay, percentage of fees charged comes down. This somewhere is related to a TER concept, total expense ratio concept. Okay, so higher the AUM, lower will be the expenses charged. Okay, lower will be the fees charged by CAMS, number one. But number two point, which is very important, is that because the equity and hybrid percentage is higher, CAMS doesn't bother a lot because the trend of people investing in equity and hybrid funds is increasing over the period of years. So anyways, more and more people are investing in equity mutual funds or in hybrid mutual funds. Is it going to be better for CAMS or not? Answer is obviously yes. Wait, one more question is still there in your mind. Will the revenue share of CAMS change if it's a direct fund or it's a regular mutual fund? So let's understand this. These are the two examples. One is a direct plan and one is a regular plan. Okay, if I'm talking about a direct plan, you can see here, management fee is 1.4%. Okay, management fee is basically what the AMC is going to charge. You can see here, 0.3% is what? 0.3% is the other fees as in RTA fee, custodian fee. So in our example, CAMS share is going to be 0.3%. But what is that zero? Zero is the distributor fee. How come zero? Obviously, because if it's a direct plan, then it's going to be zero. But if I talk about here, you can see that the management fee is the same, correct? CAMS fee, which is 0.3%, CAMS or any other charges, registrar and transfer agent, custodian, all that is 0.3. And here one more figure is being added. And what is that? That is 0.6%. This is of the distributor fee, which is going to be charged only in case of a regular plan. Okay, so I hope with this you will understand that whether it's a direct plan, whether it's a regular plan, in both cases, 0.3 figure was same, and that was the fee which CAMS was going to receive. Business model understood? Yes. Revenue model understood? Yes. Now what next? Industry analysis. If you want to check about the industry analysis, just have a look at this graph. If I'm talking about financial year ended March 15 till financial year ended March 20, the overall assets under management are increasing at a CAGR of 18%, and it is estimated to grow at a CAGR of 18% only till financial year 2025. Okay, this is one important parameter. Now you'll say, AUM increases, what is the big deal? Now you know that if AUM increases, then obviously the fees that the RTA is going to earn, that is CAMS is going to earn, that is also going to increase, right? Number one. Number two, one more very important parameter is that how much are the assets under management as compared to GDP? Okay, if you check out here, this graph tells you that in developed countries like USA, how much is AUM as a percentage of GDP? It is 120%. So in simple words, let us say USA's GDP is 100. Okay, rupees in millions, billion, trillion, dollars in whatever. Forget it. If their GDP is 100, then the overall assets under management in USA is 120. Okay, so that level is the investment level in mutual funds in advanced countries like USA. And now let's come to India. In India, it is pura 12% of GDP. So if our GDP is 100, then AUM in India is only 12. Do you see a big, big scope of increase in AUM in India? Yes. If AUM increases, who is going to be happy? CAMS. Obviously, yes. So I hope these two important points of industry analysis are absolutely clear. Now let's understand the key investors or key shareholders of CAMS. Okay, the very first one is Great Terrain. They're holding 43.53%. Second one is NSCIL. That's a subsidiary of NSC, which is holding 37.5%. So both put together are holding more than 80% in CAMS right now. This is a pre-offer equity holding. Okay, balance names you might be aware about: HDFC, HDFC Bank, HDB, and so on. All these are the current shareholders of CAMS. Out of these, who are selling is the big question. Okay, so I'm sure everyone knows what is an OFS. OFS is an offer for sale. Promoters sell their stake. I have told this 1,000 times on my channel. Okay, so who are the current shareholders who are selling the stakes? It is Great Terrain, NSCIL, Axis, HDFC and HDB Trust. Wait, this was the news which was given in the DRHP. Now, what is DRHP? It's a draft red herring prospectus. Okay, I'm shooting the video on Wednesday, which is now being released on Saturday. But till Tuesday, that is yesterday, till roughly 3 p.m., the DRHP was only available. And at 4, roughly, RHP was out. In RHP came a sudden change. And the sudden change was that all these shareholders who are going to sell the shares, whatever was given, those got cancelled out. And the RHP says that it is only NSCIL who is going to sell the shares. Now, when I read it, I was like, why this is happening? And in today's Business Standard, that is Wednesday's Business Standard, a very nice article had appeared in the newspaper as to why this is happening. Okay. It was very clearly mentioned that NACL, when they took a big stake in CAMS, they had not, complied with SEBI guidelines about the disclosure of how much they have invested in CAMS. Okay, I'm not going into the details. I'm just giving you a brief. There was some sort of non-compliance when NACL invested in CAMS. Okay, SEBI got angry. SEBI said, if you have done this as a part of non-compliance, we are asking you to do two things. Number one, whoever director you have on board for CAMS, you are now told to remove that director from the CAMS board of directors. They've complied with it already, number one. And number two, they said, you have to sell off your stake within 1 year. So when SEBI passed that, within 1 year, they had to sell off their stake in CAMS. Okay. Now, why NSCIL is selling off all their shares? Because if they don't sell off right now, what will happen? If you know this, once the shares get listed, there is a lock-in. And lock-in of how many years? 3 years lock-in. Okay. Then in that case, if NSCIL doesn't sell off entire shareholding, during this IPO, then they'll be locked in for 3 years, and then that will lead to a non-compliance of SEBI, and that is the whole reason why maybe we can see this big change of shareholders who are selling shares according to the DRHP versus according to RHP. 1,82,46,600 are the number of equity shares that are going to be offered for sale to the public. Okay. I told this figure right away because I had remembered it. So that had to come at the starting of the video. Okay. Anyways, coming back to the discussion. Out of this many shares, not less than 35% has to be reserved for retail portion. Not less than 15% has to be reserved for the NII portion. Okay. NII is often called as HNI, also high net worth individuals. Like majority of you people, not me. No, I'm not in high net worth individual. Okay. Big people, okay. And last one will be QIB. QIB will be somewhere around 50%. So these are some very basic details. How much are the number of shares which are going to be offered for which category? How much? As I'm recording the video, as of now, the exact price range has not been is not out yet in public. So I'll be making a part two of this video wherein I'll be talking about what is the price range, what is the lot size, how much is the valuation. And all that will be covered in the part 2 of this video. So as of now, offer details, this is what I can tell you. Now let's understand why they are coming up with this IPO. What are the objects of this issue? Okay. Please understand, it's 100% OFS. No fresh issue of shares. Means what? Whatever money we are going to give to the company if we apply for the shares. Out of that, how much will go to the company? Zero. Then who is going to take the entire money? It's going to be the shareholder. And who is that? NACIL. Okay. It's 100% OFS. And then why are they coming up with the issue? That's what I explained right now. To meet with the SEBI requirements. To get listed on BSE. It's going to get listed only on BSE, by the way. And to enjoy the benefits of listing. These are the only objectives of the issue. Let's come to the last point, which is peer comparison. And what is a peer comparison? Three major peers. Here you can see the figures of CAMS. Then we have Karvi, then we have Sundaram, and then we have Franklin. Okay. But please understand that Sundaram sold its RTA business to Karvi. Okay. So now remaining only two competitors. Out of that, Franklin gives its services only to Franklin Mutual Funds and no other mutual funds. So this is also gone. So now it's only two. It's only CAMS versus Karvi. Now let's do a quick comparison between these two peers, that is CAMS and Karvi. Right. If you check, the revenue from operations for CAMS is 6,996 rupees in millions. And for Karvi, it is 4,499. Okay. Fair enough. Good competition. For CAGR growth in revenue, it's 12.8%. So basically, CAMS revenue grows at 12.8% and Karvi's revenue grows at 9.1%. Chalo, still fair enough. Then if I talk about the EBITDA margins for CAMS, EBITDA margin is 42.8% and for Karvi, it is 36%. ROE, that is return on equity, for CAMS is 34.1% and for Karvi it is only 3%. And if I talk about PAT margins, for PAT, CAMS is having a PAT margin of 23.9% and Karvi is 1%. I hope you have enjoyed this part 1 of the video. Share this video with all of your friends so that they get to know about a detailed explanation of CAMS. I hope you have subscribed to my channel and hit the bell icon. And I hope you're also aware that I'm making a lot of reels on Instagram so that you get quick knowledge in 15 seconds. So that will obviously increase your financial literacy, right? So that's it from my side. I hope you have enjoyed this content. Jai Hind and bye-bye.